Hey, you know me, and you may know my brother Miles. He was very insistent that he be a part of this review of James Cameron's Avatar, which we just got back from seeing. And I guess we'll turn to you right away, because we're kind of in a little bit of a hurry, because he has to go to work very soon. So let's get your brief review out of the way.
Well, I think if we're going to look at this plot-wise, it's very close to Dances with Wolves. I mean, if we're going to be simultaneously looking at the plots, it's about a soldier that gets his leg injured in a war, in both films, and gets sent to a remote outpost, except in this time it's the plains, where in this one it's deep space. And they come into contact with an Indian tribe or an alien tribe, and they become part of that alien tribe. They learn their ways, they become a part of the tribe, they fall in love with the one native Indian that has the hots for either Sam Worthington or for Kevin Costner. American encroachment, or in this case, human encroachment, comes in looking for land, or in this case, unobtainium. And they fight them back in one last ditch effort to get them to stop. You know what?
See, I know where you're going with this. And I'll give you my brief review in two words. And then I'll expand much further on it. That's it. Seriously. That's all that... This was the story that was 10 years in the making. James Cameron...
I think you're saying 15. Which if you
15? Okay.
Which if you look at it, I think Dances with Wolves was like 1992. So, I mean, it's roughly around the same time period. And so he's... I guess you can say he was inspired by it. But
it was just like, you know, for a story that took this long, he put everything on hold. He's like, this story is too good. I have to wait until the science catches up with it, and we can animate this shit and do everything I want to do with it. You'd think in that time he could have come up with something better than this.
I don't think he put every project on hold. He was on, I think he took just like a leave from directing. He was kind of, I think he was burned out after Titanic, so he just took a leave from directing and put everything on hold. Not just Avatar, but this was, I guess, a kind of pet project that he put on the shelf until technology.
I'd be burned out after Titanic too. It's just, I cannot fathom, like, the fact that he was so enamored with this project, which, and I'm not even ragging on him for being derivative from Dances with Wolves. This is derivative from so many things that it really doesn't have an identity of its own. Because virtually everything in this movie has... It's hard because a lot of people say there's not really any original ideas left anymore, and so you can point at almost anything and point to its direct ancestor. But here, it draws from so many science fiction elements that it's really hard to... It's hard to deny that there are a lot of borrowed aspects of this, like the Dances with Wolves aspects of it, the Fern Gully aspect of this whole thing.
I think Fern Gully is being cruel to
you
it.
You think it's weak?
You're giving... Well, it's weak, but it's also giving this really strong... I mean, that's a charged word when you say Fern Gully.
Because I don't think so, because Fern Gully sucked!
No, because you're pinning it to the very worst that Hollywood liberalism has to offer.
You've got an animated movie wherein you have pointy-eared elfin creatures swinging through the forest, and there's lots of shots of evil industrialists driving gigantic bulldozers through the forest, and them weeping as the forest burns. Just, it was Fern Gully.
Isn't that a fairy?
There were fairies, yes.
I thought that was the main love interest. But.
Whatever. You had the Matrix Revolutions with the gigantic mech suits that were almost identical in design. You had actually more elements of the Matrix with the tree that would kind of download into your brain and pull your essence out and things like that. The booths that put you in these false bodies. I found it very derivative. You probably didn't, but
that was a little bit more of a stretch. I mean, I think with Dances with Wolves, yeah. I mean, I kind of showed that. Point by point, it goes along. And I think you're picking elements from other movies that match along with it, and I think that's a bit of a stretch. Now, with with it being derivative, I don't mind movies having, like, I don't want to say uninspired plots, because, I mean, if, like you said, if you look at it, how many movies are there of a cop that doesn't play by the rules, or serial killers and the hunt for them? I mean, it's not so much about the plot. It's what you do with it. It's the characters that you have. It's the dialogue. It's the action scenes.
Yeah, right. I don't mind derivative, as long as it does it well, and as long as the story it tells is worthwhile. Did it do this? Did it tell a worthwhile story? No. Did it tell it in an inspiring, original way? No. Now, everyone is going to hang... I had a real problem with this movie from the start, I'll be honest with you, because this movie from the beginning was billed as this leap forward in technology, this stepping stone, tent pole in storytelling and science fiction. Like, basically, it was coming right out, and it was kind of pre-anointed as this movie that was going to be one of the tent poles of science fiction. Like, you're going to look back on this and say, like, Avatar is when the game changed. And you think I'm exaggerating? I don't think so. I think the very early press for this was, like, it was all mysterious, and it was all shrouded in mystery, and, like, what is Avatar? Ooh. And, of course, the opening trailers told us nothing, and they were almost universally underwhelming. But do you think, just in terms of, like, you remember the initial build, do you think it succeeded in that?
Oh, hell no.
Right, I see, there you go.
But... I see a problem with both sides. I mean, I see a problem with hailing it as a masterpiece and the next... I see it as a leap in technology. You know, if here's what I'm kind of hoping for, is that James Cameron uses the same technology in his further movies. I hear he's doing Fantastic Planet or Voyage.
Fantastic Voyage.
But, you know, if he can use the same technology and adapt it to other science fiction stories, I think that's tremendous, but I think the problem was on both sides. Whenever you hype anything up, I don't care what it is, as being the best movie of 2009, the best drama, the best acting performance, immediately people are going to go in going, well, I wasn't blown away, and then all of a sudden you get a backlash from the other side. I mean, if you came in... not knowing anything about the press, which is impossible, but the build up, the reviews, all this. If you just came in and watched it, I think you'd be entertained. Is kind of what I'm getting at with my review.
I don't. I think if you've ever seen a science fiction movie in your life, if you were alive in the '90s, I think you're going to be sorely underwhelmed with this picture. I think I am part of that backlash. I am very much against this pervasive CG presence, and I'll tell you the truth, it rubs me the wrong way. I don't like it. I think it's distracting. I don't think they've ever managed to, like, make me think, like, ooh, that's real or something. And it's not to do with suspension. Well, there is. Actually, you know what? I'm going to go here right now. This movie, I never got swept up in it. Ever. And it has to do with this fantastical world and these weird aliens that are supposedly being put on screen. And I think there actually is a real disconnect between, like, my ability to suspend my disbelief with, say, Star Wars, which I was very easily able to, like, believe in these aliens, which, by the way, in the early episodes were, in the original series, were practical effects. And the aliens here, I had so many problems with Pandora, the Na'vi, all these various aspects of it that I just shook my head and went bullshit at. For instance, the Na'vi themselves. I don't have a problem with them being big and tall or really strong. What I had a problem with, every time they did it, I had to shake my head and just go no, was their hair. You know the hair thing? What they would do is their hair is like a USB interface to everything on Pandora. Like, when they wanted to ride their horses, their big alien horses, they would swing on and I'm not shitting you, they would plug their hair into their horses. They would have flying pterodactyls, and they'd plug their hair into the pterodactyls. They would plug their hair into the fucking trees and talk to the trees. It was bullshit at its best and insulting at its worst, because you're taking this whole concept of the natives having some kind of connection with nature, and then you're just going and making it literal, which I think is offensive even to that concept, to having some kind of literal firewire connection to fucking trees. I hated it.
Well, that was a lot. To go back to what you were talking about with CGI, I think it has its applications. I think it has its uses. I think it is cheaper when doing something on a grander scale. Take something like District 9, where you have gigantic aliens and spaceships being a virtual presence on the Earth. And that's something that, if you used practical effects for, I think would be astronomical. But for a movie of... which is... I almost want to say it's like a big-budget independent movie, if you want to say it like that. Then yes, CGI has its place there. What I don't like CGI for is when it can be used for practical effects, and they do it anyway. I was talking about this before on other places, but... basically, when you can do it yourself, then why do it? Like, CGI blood. Blood has been around, blood effects have been around for since the beginning.
You're talking about Ninja Assassin.
Yeah, and when you do CGI blood effects, it just makes me shake my head and wonder why. And the other one is kind of Fast and the Furious. The whole point behind car movies, I would say car porn, but... It's all about seeing the cars and seeing them in action, doing actual stunts and being driven on real world courses. And when you have these cartoon cars going around in different locales, it makes me want to play my PS2. It doesn't make me want to enjoy the action.
Right, and there's a disconnect there where you don't have the same emotional connection as you do with real actors. For instance, let's just take the war scenes in Avatar. And which were impressive, by the way, but you never felt like anyone was doing anything. You were watching a cartoon. And a very good cartoon can be very good. But let's take, for instance, Jackie Chan movies. You see Jackie Chan fighting around there. That's Jackie. He's actually busting his ass. He's hurting himself. He's putting himself at risk. He is doing something to entertain us. And I just, there is kind of a weight and an impact and emotional investment in a real actor that I never manage to get into with these characters.
I see Avatar as different, though, because it's almost entirely animated. Yep. I mean, there are human characters, but I almost see this as an animated movie, like an anime, except with these motion capture. So it was actually very easy to me to get immersed in this, because it is an entire world. You look at other movies with CGI in it, it's not a bunch of real-world actors in a real-world setting, and all of a sudden this magic CGI sprite comes in, and you see them talking to a golf ball or something like that.
Yeah, I'm not entirely sure most of the real actors in here weren't animated as well, like the Angry Colonel guy. Was it Stephen Lang was his name?
I don't remember.
Whatever, go ahead.
But I think when the whole movie is animated... and I say again, for the most part, there are some live-action actors in there, but when the whole thing is animated, I kind of looked at it as the same way as seeing an animated movie, and it's the whole world, so that I didn't see the same suspension of disbelief as I do with other movies that have CGI in it.
I just didn't see how other parts of Pandora I didn't buy. The floating fucking mountains... what the fuck was that? You know, that doesn't happen except on fucking heavy metal album covers. You don't have flying mountains. You can't just say like, oh, there's the flying mountains of Hallelujah. And then they just start flying around. And there's waterfalls coming off the flying fucking mountains. Where is the water on the flying mountains coming from? How are the mountains flying? You can't just throw that in my face and be like, accept this, because I can't. It's bullshit. I'm calling bullshit. This movie is bullshit. Yeah.
Bullshit.
I'm serious. All right. You know what I'm really tired of? I'm going to go off on one of my rants here. You know, forget Dances with Wolves. Forget all of the other movies that I've seen that pattern this stereotypical Hollywood plot of the white man going to these people that he initially considers to be godless savages, and learning their ways, falling in love with them, and eventually siding with them against the imperialist regime that was initially a part of. Dances with Wolves. The Last Samurai. You know what? Fuck you. I can tell when I'm being lectured, okay? I have had enough of these crappy Hollywood movies that are totally invested in white guilt, that are supposed to make me feel bad about all the dirty things that we did to the Native Americans, all the nasty things that people have done to other cultures over the course of time. You know what? White people were sons of bitches to the Indians. White people were sons of bitches to black people. Everyone has been of a son of a bitch to everybody. And you know what? I do feel bad. I'm sorry. But what am I supposed to do about it? You know, I've seen every permutation of this fucking story told. I've had enough of it. And it's not even a paper-thin allegory here. There is no allegory. This movie is preachy from beginning to end. It's telling us that Americans are imperialist dogs, that we should feel bad about all the things we've done. Mission fucking accomplished. And the reason I say that is because they're not even attempting to hide their symbolism anymore. You know what? The Na'vi are sitting on top of a giant mountain of unobtainium. They don't even bother trying to disguise what the metal is that people want. You know what? They might as well just call it fucking oil. We're going in to drive these stinking, these blue-skinned people off their mountain to get their fucking oil. And we're going to, since they won't leave and they don't know anything, they don't worship our god, we're gonna daisy-cutter their fucking holy tree. And in what they're actually calling a shock and awe campaign, you know what? Fuck this preachy bullshit. I'm just tired of it. I felt condescended to. I felt insulted. I'm tired of it. This movie eats. Thank you.
Oh, that was a whole palate load I have to answer for. Okay. Wow, where do I begin?
I feel better now.
Have your sandwich.
You go ahead.
It's easy to get angry at this sort of thing, but if you were to go,
you've lost your train of thought completely. See, you can't defend this.
No, I can. I mean, if you look at a Holocaust movie and you say, oh, yeah, we shouldn't kill Jews, the mission accomplished, or if we look at a movie that says that, like, racism is bad. You know, you could say, obviously, racism is bad, duh. But, I mean, that doesn't make the message any less true. I mean, we've had movies like To Kill a Mockingbird, and I'm not comparing this movie to Kill a Mockingbird.
You better fucking not.
But I'm just using it as an example where you can say, oh, yeah, tolerance. We should all have tolerance, or you know, we shouldn't be racist. That's obvious, but it's not. I mean, but it's all about learning to understand each other and as humans to come together and to be empathetic and sympathetic toward other people's problems. And it's easy to brush it away, but I don't see the major issue with it. I don't see it being outrageous.
I'm not brushing it away. I just feel like this is a morality play told to a fucking four-year-old, and I feel like I'm being spoken down to. It's not even trying. It's... Alright. It's obvious that I have issues. It's obvious that Miles was able to kind of switch off that part of his brain that has reason and logic. I'm kidding. But I suppose it's worth talking about the various aspects of the movie that were good and that were bad, kind of going through it. And I will have a lot more problems with this thing, but what did you think of, say, the ensemble cast?
The main players I liked. Sam Worthington, I think, is becoming one of those actors that is going to be relied upon for a lot of action movies. You know, he, not only does he have the physical aspect, but he's a good actor also. I mean, you saw that in Terminator Salvation. He's pretty much the only thing I liked out of Terminator Salvation. And he's able to give these kind of good performances with limited say, limited, you know, writing on their part.
Limited is kind.
But he's able to give good performances despite all that. So I liked him, and I was also surprised by Sigourney Weaver. Also, with she's got a bit part in this, but she did a good job. Otherwise, everyone else really has. Oh, Zoe Bell. She did
no, not Zoe Bell. Saldana.
Zoe Bell was a Death Proof.
Yeah.
Okay. That's
shame
not
on
her.
You. But she was very good.
But she was very good. Everyone else kind of had really pared down.
Everyone
roles.
Else chewed Pandora and shit it out. Okay, here I go again. Who do I start with? I think I would like to start with I forget his name, Jason Lang or whatever, Justin Lang, so the guy who played the big scarred colonel dude. I loved this guy.
He was great
because he was horrible, but he was so blissfully.
But he was funny.
He was funny, and I don't think he was supposed to be funny, but he was, and I was entertained the whole time. He was like he lit up the screen every time he was on there. He played probably the most over the top. Pardon me, hard-assed, like, hoorah marine motherfucker in the world. And you just, like, every time he opened his mouth, you could not believe the chest-thumping, saber-rattling, hoorah American bullshit coming out of his mouth. Just, it was amazing. I just love that everything about this guy, like, every time you walked in, he was, like, bench-pressing, like, 900 pounds.
Come on! Come on! Put more weight on!
He's like,
I see... Come on!
He's like, I need more weight. We can't let Pandora allow us to get us soft. And he's like, I got a steel boner all the time for killing people. Woo!
You need a spot? No, I don't need a spot.
What kind of pussy are you? And then, like, they're breaking out of the base, and the atmosphere is unbreathable to humans, and he sees this ship taking off. He's like, motherfucker, no way he live. And he's like, sir, you need a mask. He's like, I don't need no fucking mask.
Screw you, I don't need to breathe.
He's like, pussy, I can hold my breath for 15 minutes. And so he goes, he's like, ah! So I also love, even his mech was badass, the little robot mech he was driving. That, he even had it custom made to be, like, a hard motherfucker. Like, okay, I'm gonna get to a spoiler here, but, like, his mech has a knife, and it has, like, a 9-foot-long knife. It's like a commando knife, but made for a mech, and, like, no other guy has this. And you just know, he was like, that mech is too pussy for me. You know what it needs? A big fucking knife.
Why would you need a knife, sir?
Silence, pussy! I want a big fucking knife on that fucking mech, and I want it right fucking now!
Somehow put a dick on it, too.
He's like, my mech needs a gigantic steel boner so I can fuck people while I stab them with my big knife. I'm gonna robo-fuck them. Nice!
He also had his subtle evil moments, too, like he's clear-cutting the woods and he's got his cup of coffee.
That's good stuff.
That's a good cup of coffee. Nice to have while killing indigenous folk.
It's like, wait for the sanctions to take effect. Enough of this pussy bullshit. Load up the incendiary rounds. Woo!
You even had Giovanni Ribisi in one scene where he's trying to, maybe we should try to talk him out, and he's kind of like...
Giovanni Ribisi was actually awesome in this movie, because this is another reason I felt insulted by this movie, because this movie made no attempt to hide, like, between shades of gray. There was no gray morality here. There was the evil, imperious American motherfuckers, and then there was the noble blue-skinned savage who knew everything and was pure and righteous and could do no wrong. And so Giovanni Ribisi plays the corporate head of this mining operation that's trying to get the unobtainium. And so, like, everything, every second, you could tell Cameron was like, how do I write him to be more douchey? And he's like, I know, we'll have him set up a putting green, and we're gonna have him putting, and like telling other people, like, look at me putt, look at the, woo, and then,
there's people dying outside.
He's like, hold on, yeah. So, like, this guy, he would bring putting, like, golf clubs on the fucking set, and he's like, He would be using like ethnic slurs. He's like, "Get these blue monkeys out of my fucking tree." And
I swore I thought he had the same name as the douche and alien.
Yeah, his name
Paul
is
Reiser
what
character.
Is it Carter?
His name is Parker.
Parker.
And I could have swore for the longest time, again, I have lack of sleep, but I could have swore the douche in Aliens was Parker, but it's Burke.
It's Burke, yeah. but we were like, I was thinking the exact same thing. Is he the same name as the corporate asshole in Aliens? Because it's so close. And, like, this guy was so transparently evil. The only thing they didn't have him do was, like, put a gigantic oiled handlebar mustache and have him, like, twirl it menacingly. Like, smoking a cigarette in one of those holders. Like, ah! It's like, go ahead. But my favorite scene was, they're like, they've been infiltrating this camp of Na'vi for a long time, and it's not working out. They're like, it's fairly obvious that they're not going to leave this tree. And so they're gearing up for war. And so Ribisi is like, I've given you 3 months with those fucking savages, and you haven't done anything. It's time to burn them alive. And they're like, and Sigourney Weaver's like, you don't understand. They have a literal connection with nature. They can plug their heads into the ground and talk to their ancestors.
She gives her impassioned Chaitel a look for speech in 2012, where we all got to get together, and we got to be one people. He's just like,
it's like we're all connected.
We're all
don't
connected.
You see?
It's just like the plants and the animals. They all have this connection. It's a little connection, and they can plug into each other, and so it's one big brain.
He's like, you don't know what you're destroying.
It's like you don't get it. We all got to get together and love one another. And
so Giovanni, he looks really touched. He's like,
and then he goes.
These guys have souls.
Oh, wow.
Oh, they must have some good peyote down in that camp, I tell you what. Is that napalm loaded up yet, Colonel? He's like, look, you'd better get down there, otherwise it's going to smell like blue ham for the next 2 months. We're going to put a hole in their culture memory so deep, you can spit all the way to China. I just love that reaction. He's like... That's good.
It's kind of that same reaction by Oliver Platt in 2012, where it's just like they're going into the Ark and his character's going like, wait a minute, you mean that people bought their way onto this ship?
He's
and Oliver
like,
Platt's like,
oh no,
you mean, oh, life's not fair?
There was another scene that really, you liked the scene where... They basically it's a given that there's going to be a war between the Earthlings and the Na'vi, and so they're like, fuck it, we're gonna lock and load, and we're gonna like put a ridiculous amount of missiles on our weapons. Get me every guy you can find.
Yeah, this is there's a scene where the general, or the colonel I should say, is giving a speech that we're gonna blast these guys back into the, even deeper than the Stone
deeper,
Age.
Yeah,
and he's got all the men assembled, and like the first two rows. Somehow, in deep space, on this marine mining expedition, we have two rows of the biggest, most white trash, mullet-wearing,
tailgating Alabama inbred...
Eastbound, bend down, Appalachia crackers that you can find. And I had turned to you and go, where the hell's the moonshine?
you like expected them to be like, wear like beer helmets on, be like...
Yeah, kill them natives. Woo!
They're gonna kill us some Indians. Woo! Go. We hate them redskins. They're blueskins. Blueskins!
Yeah.
Screw them! It's like, I brought all sorts of explosives in my pickup truck. The right of a well regulated militia, the right of Americans to bear arms for not being friends. Yeah! And
shut up, squeal like a pig.
But probably the most nonsensical line I remember was actually in that scene where he's like, the general's like, we are gonna buttfuck these savages. And that wasn't the line. But the line is, he's like, we are gonna fight terror with terror. And I was like, what terror? They haven't done anything. It was like, they have not, like, you might have bought it, maybe, if they were, like, leaving the corpses of Marines out as some kind of example. Like, we will not allow trespass, but they have literally done nothing. And he's like, these people are terrorists. I was like, oh, seriously.
They hiss.
I was like, Cameron, fuck you. Fuck you and your terrorist subtext. I just hated this shit. Now, I don't know if I mentioned this, but I will grant you, the battle scene at the end of the movie is very, very good. It's well done. It was exciting. I think it focused well on the various heroes that were established in the movie. It didn't get mired in shaky cam. It allowed for a lot of heroic moments. There was a very good fight scene at the end between the colonel guy. I mean, you knew this was coming, but, you know, it was... I thought it was well done. But, I mean, sometimes there's movies that are worth sitting through an hour and a half of crap to get to the big climax. I just don't think this was good enough. Now, I did not watch this in 3D. Neither of us did. I don't know. Apparently this was the intended medium for this movie. Do you think the 3D would have contributed all that much?
It would be a nice feature, but it's not. It wouldn't have completely blown my mind, changed my opinion on what was going on. It's always, like, Beowulf, all the Zemeckis films, which probably do the 3D the best. I mean, it like I said, it's always a nice feature, and it's nice to look at, but it doesn't completely change the way I look at movies. It's a nicety. That's it.
You know what? If I had the opportunity to, I mean, I could have gone to see the 3D. I just didn't want to. And to me, it's never seen more than a gimmick. And I just don't think, I actually don't think I would be physically capable of sitting through this movie for that long with 3D. Because even though it's the good kind of 3D that's not, that is easier on the eyes, that's still a long time to expect people to sit through a 3D movie.
That's actually a complaint I have also, is that this movie is long. It's 2 hours and 40 minutes.
It wasn't that long. It felt long.
It's 160 minutes. So, yeah.
Two hours and 20 minutes. Wait.
Two hours and 40 minutes. We're bad at math.
Yeah, I'm tired.
but you really only have the big climactic battle scene, which takes up about 30 minutes or so of it. Even I was... It gets bogged down in the middle, and there isn't a lot of action beats in this movie, which is I'd say a mark against it. Even if I were recommending this as a big budget action movie, that there's not a whole lot of action in this. There's a lot in the end, and there's a few parts in between, but it's a little too far in between for me.
I got one more complaint, and this is going back a little bit, but you know, this movie to me. I did not buy the ecology of this planet. I'm not talking about the floating mountains anymore, but I'm talking like, you know how, like, when they were walking through the woods, every footstep of theirs was illuminated by the magic plants, and there was these magical flying amoebas or, like, jellyfish flying around, and I'm sorry, I didn't buy it. It looked to me like they were walking around the Night Elf Forest in World of Warcraft. And it was too much. There was too much wonderment and whimsy in this movie, and I think that we kind of fell into the George Lucas trap of just too damn much. Am I wrong? Like,
it is a lot. But again, I did like the special effects in this movie. I do think they're, like, we were talking about. I really loved Sigourney Weaver's avatar. I found that...
Yeah.
That was one of the most surprising things of this movie, is Sigourney Weaver has this avatar that she goes into, and it looks fantastic. It was the best rendered avatar of the whole bunch.
Yeah, I mean, the facial... It really was a wonderful thing to see such good facial expressions on these characters.
And she could almost be an action star again if it were, like, another animated movie. I mean, I almost see the possibilities of her kind of being another Ripley in another action movie, except, like, all CGI, where you can kind of have her in this younger role.
Yeah, it's like, why do we need actors anymore? Really? We can just animate everything. This is my problem, you know? Okay. You've pretty much got to go very soon, so I think we better wrap this up. And I guess... Final thoughts. I'll start with me, because I'm me. At best, this is a middle-of-the-road picture. And whether or not... Let's just dismiss my complaints against the preachy nature of it, the derivative nature of it. I would not give this any more than a passable science fiction movie grade. Perhaps worth watching, but even then I think it's too long, it's too slow, and it just brings nothing new to the table. It is a technical achievement in animation, but that alone is not enough to sell me a ticket. Is it worth... Was it worth all the money? Was it worth the time and the wait? Was this story good enough to earn the hype? No, on all counts, this movie is a severe and shocking disappointment, and I would not recommend it.
What might be surprising to you is that I actually share a lot of your problems with it, and I agree with you on a lot of the issues. I just don't get the... Not just you, but especially a lot of other people, just the real bile and resentment toward the movie. I'll just go on to saying that this movie doesn't make my top 20, it doesn't make my top 30 or anything like that, but, and I've seen a lot of movies, so my list is pretty big, but just going into it, it is a spectacle to look at. It is one of the few times that I actually marvel at CGI. I think the whole world is so beautiful to look at that that really is the selling point of this movie, and they make no attempt to hiding it. I don't think anyone is going to credit the story as great because it's not, or that it's preachy because it is. But the spectacle of it and the final battle scenes and just looking at it all on screen is amazing to me, and I enjoyed that part of it. I enjoyed a lot of the other stuff. I enjoyed Sam Worthington. I enjoyed Sigourney Weaver. I enjoyed the hammy performances. you hated them,
yeah.
But I was laughing at it. I mean, it is something to see these
Let me put it this way. For all the technical wonderment that was supposedly going to set this movie apart as kind of like a gold standard for animation, I think it falls short in every way to several other major movies, like 2012. I thought 2012 was a better movie and a bigger achievement in special effects than Avatar. It was outdone. Do you have a basis for comparison on this one, or do you just... let's just put those two side to side. Which one would you think you would rather watch if you were, say, it was better?
I would still say Avatar. Yeah. I mean, they're still 2012.
They're very different movies.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's apples and oranges. I mean, they're both effects movies, but it's... But, I mean, it's an okay movie. I mean, that... And, like I said, my opinion is not that far off. It's just, I didn't get pissed off at this movie. I just kind of saw it for what it is. It's an animated movie. It's beautiful to look at. There's some good action in it. There's some good performances, and I see a lot more potential in the medium than that. But it's okay. Good,
yeah.
And that's probably the biggest disappointment is that it's good. It's not great. It's not a masterpiece. Yeah. And if I were to recommend it, you know maybe when it gets cheaper or when it gets, I would say watch it in theaters if you're gonna watch it, but not pay full price for it, but because it's good to see it in the big screen than say on your average home movie theater system. But yeah, it's good.
Okay, thanks for watching, everybody. Point counterpoint. Have a good night, everyone.